Everyone, Mr. Minix, my name, math is my game. Today, on this fine day, I'm joined by the best Algebra 2 A class I've had in a long time, if not ever. You can tell they're super excited to be here. I'm going to give a shout out to the future Mr. Minix. You're doing a great job. Keep it up. Don't beat yourself up too much about what they told you on the spaceship. Chapter 6. Section 2, we're multiplying and dividing expressions that are really awesome, expressions that are radical. So we probably need to take a trip down memory lane with some of this. And I'll be talking about Newton Falls. Now, if you don't know, I live in Newton Falls. I live there because it's close to where I grew up, because there's two sets of waterfalls, because there's pretty decent fishing at both sets of waterfalls. You can catch walleye. This time of year, walleye are going to start hitting. So, anyway, memory lane. We had this rule that said the square root of AB is the square root of A times the square root of B. Now, that statement is true in both directions. Okay, not just in one direction. I can't believe I said in one direction. but anyway, there's another statement that says the square root of A over B is the square root of A over the square root of B. Now, this is true as long as A and B are positive. As long as A and B, well, I guess A could be zero, but B can't be zero, because then we would have bad things happening in the fractions. But the index might change, you know, so anytime we have a natural number as the index, usually that's going to be something like 2 or 3 or 4 or 5. But those are the properties that we're going to use. Another rule, another property that you might need to know is that if you had some number A, and it were raised to the power m over n, that it's the exact same thing as taking the nth root of a to the m, which is the same thing as taking the nth root of a, that whole quantity, to the m. Okay, so these are some properties of square roots that we're going to be using, or exponents. Any questions so far? You know, I love questions. Questions are how I learn. I usually learn at least one new thing a week. Over the weekend, I learned that hawks, even though they're, I think hawks are like my spirit animal, hawks are not invincible. One of my hawk buddies, well, better not say too much, but anyway. All right, here we go. Example 1, multiply and simplify. So suppose we had something like the third root of 9x squared y to the fifth times the third root of 3x to the fourth y, something like that. Couldn't we just combine? Yes, that's what we're going to do. We're going to kind of play squeeze play on these. What I mean by that, and you got to realize that this only works if the indexes are the same. If the indexes aren't the same, you can't squeeze these things together. Okay, but since the indices are the same, what I'm going to do is rewrite this as the third root of, now I'm going to go ahead and put the 9 and the 3 together. So under this third root, I can have 9 times 3, which is going to become 27. And something special is going to happen to that, you'll see. And then what am I going to have? I'm going to have times x to the 6. Ooh, yeah, that's going to be nice. Something great's going to happen there. Because x to the 6th is like x cubed times x cubed. Interesting. And then y to the sixth also? Good. Y to the sixth also. So that's like another y cubed and y cubed. You might ask yourself, why would you write it that way? Well, you'll see. When it's 70 and sunny in Newton Falls, like it's going to be on Friday, everybody, even people who can't walk, even people who can't stand up, and there are people who can't walk in Newton Falls, believe me, I know, and there are people who can't stand up, everybody in Newton Falls is outside, soaking it up. What I mean by that, if you haven't figured it out, is each one of these things now under our third root is a perfect cube. And it's going to go out and play. So what's the cube root of 27? 3. And what's the cube root of x cubed? Well, some of you are jumping ahead of the game. The cube root of x cubed is just x. The cube root of x to the sixth is x squared. And the reason, in case you're wondering why on earth I wrote what I did the way I did, I wrote this x to the sixth as x cubed times x cubed just to kind of show you that what's going to happen is the cube root of x cubed is x, and the cube root of the other cube, x cubed, is also x. So it will end up being x squared there. Is everybody good with that idea? I hope. Okay. And then the same thing happens with the y, right? So then the same thing happens with the y. It's going to be y squared. Awesome. How do we feel about this first example? Pretty good? Make sense? Awesome. So keep in mind that that's what happens when it's sunny and 70 in Newton Falls. Everybody goes out and plays. Everybody goes outside. So let's keep it 70 and sunny in Newton Falls. Example 2, find the quotient, and simplify, and simplify. So suppose we have the fourth root of 25 x to the negative sixth y to the 30th all over, oh man, all over the fourth root of 25 x to the second y to the second. That's what's kind of tricky. First of all, what's going to happen with the 25s? They're going to cancel. Is everybody cool with that? And we get 1s, and the 4th root of 1 is 1. So the 25s are going to go, bye-bye-bye-bye. Mathematicians really don't like negative exponents. So if we think about it, we're going to have some kind of fraction. We're going to have some kind of fraction where in the numerator we're going to have a 4th root. Well, I guess we could do the 4th root like of this. We could do this. That'd be all right. The x to the negative 6 and the x to the second, they're either going to go to the top or the bottom, but let's try to put them somewhere where the exponent's going to be positive. So where's that going to put them, the top or the bottom? The bottom, it's going to make x to the what? X to the 8th, we subtract. So in the bottom, it's x to the 2 minus minus 6. So in the bottom, we're going to have x to the 8th in the denominator there. Now in the numerator, again, we want positive exponent, so we're going to have what? Y to the 28th up top. And I made those fourth root bars way too long. That's okay. It's still sunny, and it's still 70 in Newton Falls. So, what's going to happen here? Y to the 7th over x squared. Now, you know that in Newton Falls, they have the best Chinese food at the main moon. And you know when I call them, make that order, they say, anything here. And yeah, there is something else. That person that I said that couldn't walk or that couldn't stand up, they need to be held up by something. And this one of these terms needs some encouragement. because we don't know if it's positive or negative. And if it's negative, then some bad things would happen. The y to the seventh needs absolute values. Good. Awesome. So if you forgot about the even-even-odd rule, the even-even-odd rule, the even-even-odd rule says if the index is even and the term under the radical has an even exponent, and when you simplify it, then we end up with something that's odd, that term is going to need absolute value bars around it. Okay? We are going to need to force that unknown y, we are going to need to say that that has to be positive. It could be around the 7-2 or just around the y. Either way is fine. Yep. How do we feel about these first two examples? Is it making sense so far? Okay. So that's what happens when it's 70 and sunny in Newton Falls. Question? Does it need to be positive or negative? Terrific question. Terrific question. Does it need to be positive or negative? If we're dealing with variables and we're simplifying, we don't need positives or negatives. Now, to juxtapose that, if they said find all the fourth roots of the number 625, so the fourth root of 625, well, 5 is one of them and negative 5 is the other one, then you would need the plus or minus. Okay. So whenever we're dealing with variables and simplifying, almost all the time we don't need the plus or minus. If you're finding numeric roots and the question says find all the roots of, then we need the plus or minus. Really good question. Another question. Okay. So what happens in Newton Falls when it's 58 and sunny? There's still some people outside. So here we go. We're going to Newton Falls. It's 58 and sunny. Simplify cube root 3x squared y times the cube root of 3x squared y to the fourth times the cube root of 9xy, and that's it. So now it's a nice sunny 58 degree day in Newton Falls. There's going to be some people out playing basketball, believe it, and there's going to be some people staying inside. So again, all of our indices are the same. It's real important that you recognize whether or not the indices are the same. If they're not, you can't do that squeeze play idea. So we're going to get the third root of all kinds of stuff. Let's go ahead and put all the numbers together. 81, good. Now, later on, I'm going to rewrite that 81 as the product of two things. I'm not going to write it as 81. You'll see what that's about in a minute. What about my x's? X to the what? X to the fifth. Awesome. Later on, I'm going to rewrite my x's as the product of two different things. You'll see what that's going to be in a minute. And then my y's. Y to the sixth. Good. Now the y to the sixth, that one's cool. I don't think I'm going to mess with that. I like that one. Okay. So who can read my mind and tell me how I'm going to rewrite 81? Yes. When you have to break down a square root, you use a perfect square factor. So the goal here is we're going to be having to break down a cube root of something that's not a perfect cube, right? So what we do is we rewrite the term, this 81, in terms of, okay, what factors does it have that are a perfect cube? And 81's perfect cube factor is 27. So what that means is 27's third root's going to pop out of this. And it's going to go outside and play. What is 27's cubed root? 3. So a 3 pops out of the root altogether. Okay. Awesome. How's everybody feeling so far about this one? Okay. All right. So staying inside high and dry, there's going to be something else staying inside. That 27 times 3. 3 is not a perfect cube, is it? So there's going to be a 3 that's going to hang out inside still. To be clear, this 3 down here is the same as this 3 up here. Okay. To be clear, this 3 that came out is the cubed root of this 27. Okay. So who can read my mind and tell me how I'm going to rewrite that x to the fifth? Yeah. Nice. X cubed times x squared. Perfect. Awesome. Good. That's x cubed times x squared. Okay. So, x cubed's cube root is going to go outside and play. So that's going to bring an x out. Now, x squared's not a perfect cube, is it? So guess what? It's staying inside. So the x squared's going to stay under the radical. We're almost done here. Anything else going to go out and play? Y to the second, good. Y to the 6th cube root, or y to the second's going to go out and play. And that leaves all the y's accounted for, and that's it. This down here would be the answer. What do we think about simplifying these? Does it make sense? Okay. So the question is, how hard is it going to be when we get into what? When the indices are different, you just can't do anything with them. Yeah, when the indices are different, you just can't do anything with them, yeah. Where it is going to get challenging is when we have some stuff that doesn't simplify in the bottom. Because remember, it's not cool to leave a radical in the denominator. So let's take this nice and slow here. 1 over rad 2 is not in simplest form. You're going to take trig, some of you. And that's a horrible answer, 1 over rad 2. Your trig teacher's going to smack you a little bit and say that's not cool. So we want to get that so that there's no radical in the denominator. There is going to be a radical in the numerator. Anybody remember how we handle this? Right, we multiply it by rad 2 over rad 2. So a lot of times we overlook the steps, the process, what ends up happening. On the bottom then, we get rad 2 times 2, which ends up becoming rad 4, which ultimately becomes 2. Right, which ultimately becomes 2. Yeah. So another question about the positive negative. If you're just simplifying, don't worry about it. But if it says find all the roots, we need the plus or minus. Okay. Really good questions coming up today. I like them. I like them a lot. So when we get this rad 2 here, we're still going to have a rad 2 here. And this is going to end up being a rad 2. So the answer ends up being rad 2 over 2. Is everybody cool with that one? So let's do a whole bunch of these. What about 1 over rad 3? What's that going to become? Rad 3 over 3. What about 1 over rad 6? What's that going to become? Rad 6 over 6. Everybody all right so far? Okay. See if you can stay with me here. What if we had 2 over rad 8? So it's going to become 2 rad 8 over 8. And then 2 eighths can reduce, can't it? So that's rad 8 over 4, but rad 8 can simplify now. Can't it? Rad 8, yeah, is 4 times 2. So 4 square root's going to pop out of that. Yeah, because that's 4 times 2. So that's going to be 2 rad 2 over 4. Oh my gosh. So the 4 and the 2 cancel. So this ends up being what? Rad 2 over 2. There's more than one way to the Eastwood Mall. If we had done this right from the beginning, if we had said this is 2 over 2 rad 2, if we had done it that way first, let's see if it would have taken fewer steps. Then this would have been 2 rad 2 over 2 times 2, which would be 2 rad 2 over 4, which is rad 2 over 2. About the same number of steps, really. 6 and 1 half dozen in the other. I love that expression. It's an old person expression. I'm feeling old. I'm not calling your dad old, by the way. But here we go. Example number 5. Simplify. Simplify. I got skills in simplifying. And I'm losing control. Let's try the square root. Love this one. The square root of 50 over the square root of 10. This one kind of reminds me of how I used to go to Youngstown from Niles. Anybody ever been in Youngstown or Niles? Yeah, I used to do a really silly thing to go from Youngstown from Niles to Youngstown. What do we got? It's just rad 5. If you play squeeze play right from the beginning, you could say it's rad 50 over 10. So it's rad 5. If you hadn't have done that, maybe you would have said, okay, so this is 25 times 2, so it's 5 rad 2 over rad 10. And then you say, okay, so this is 5 rad 2 rad 10 over 10. So this is rad 20 over 2. And 20 is 4 times 5, so that's 2 rad 5 over 2. So it's rad 5, yeah. It just, all you did, rad, okay, yeah. Yeah, there's a lot of different ways you could go about doing this one. Yeah. So, we ready to try one more? Last one. Here we go. Example 6. Let's go with the 4th root of 4th root of 256 x to the negative 3rd y to the 7th z to the 50th all over. The 4th root of 4096 x to the 10th y to the negative 1st Z to the 67th. I think this will do a good job of figuring things out. So first of all, the 256 and the 4096. A lot of times when we find quotients, we don't want to make more fractions than we already have, right? So I guess It seems as though they're going to have common factors, doesn't it? So maybe we could just, under the fourth root, maybe figure out what this what's this going to be? 256 over 4096. Is that going to reduce down at all? They're both even. Let's do what your sixth grade teacher said to do. They're both even. 256 over 4096. They're both even, so that's 128 over 2048. They're both even, so that's 64 over 1024. They're both even, that's 32 over 512. They're both even, that's 16 over 256. They're both even, that's 8 over 128. They're both even, that's 4 over 60. They're both even, that's 2 over 32, that's 1/16. That was a good guess. So that's going to be 1/16. Okay. So what's going to happen with the X's? Is it going to be x to the 7th? X to the negative 13th? X to the positive 13th? It's going to be x to the negative 13th up top, or the x to the positive 13th is going to drop to the denominator, right? So we'll have x to the 13th down in the denominator, I guess. And then what? Why am I making it to do what now? If I'm looking at my x's, x to the negative 3rd over x to the 10th would be x to the negative 3 minus 10. It would be x to the negative 13th if I wrote it. Oh, where I'm writing it here instead of all the way down here? I don't know. I don't know. I guess I'll put it down there, too. So it's going to be, what, x to the 13th here? Now, let's think about that. I am going to split that up. X to the what? I'm looking for powers, or to the what? I could do better than 8. 12th. X to the 12 times x to the 1st, right? Now, what about my z's? Let's take the y's first. Where are the y's going to go? Top, and it's going to be y to the 8th. Okay, so I get a y to the 8th up top. And I don't even need to repurpose that one, do I? Okay. And then what do I get? Z to the 17th, where? In the bottom. Z to the 17th, or I can repurpose that as a z to the 16th times z. Okay. Man, this one's a nightmare. Wow. Told you this would be the last one. I wasn't lying. So let's see. Out of the top. Oh, everything out of the top pops out, doesn't it? What pops out of the top? 4 through to 1 is 1. 4 through to y to the 8 is y to the squared. Now, what's going to end up in the denominator? 4 through to 16 is 2. 4 through to x to the 12th is x cubed. Do I need those things? Yeah. And then, what about the Z? A Z to the 4th is going to pop out. Now, there is some stuff left over, isn't there? Dang it. Because there ends up being an X and a Z left over under a 4th root, right? And that's in the denominator. So there ends up being in the denominator, so it's like times, you know, 1 over the fourth root of xz. So this is blight. Anybody know what that word blight is? B-L-I-G-H-T. Anybody ever hear that word? It's not good. It's bad. We got to get rid of it. So here's where we have to magically turn this tractor into a field. Guess what I'm going to multiply by? The fourth root of x. Well, I want to turn it so that all my stuff under the radical goes away. So I'm going to multiply by the fourth root of x to the... See if we can figure this one out. This is tough. I want to turn x into a perfect fourth. X to the third. X to the third and x to the third. And what about the y's? Or the z's, I mean, thank you. Is it going to be the same thing on the z's then? It's going to be the same thing on the z's. So z cubed, z cubed. So what's going to end up happening then is we're going to get... This is where it gets kind of confusing, if it hasn't been already. This and this are going to be a fourth root of x, right? So guess what's going to end up popping out of the bottom? A whole nother power of x, right? Okay. Oh, man. So in the bottom then, I'm not going to have 2 times x cubed. I'm going to have 2x to the fourth. And then isn't that going to bring out a whole nother power of z now? Not now. And then what's going to happen with the z's? It's going to bring out a whole other power of z, right? So it's going to be z to the fifth, and that now will need to be an absolute value. Up top, there was a y squared. And there's going to end up being then a fourth root of x cubed, z cubed up top. And that's the answer. Oh, my gosh. Thank goodness that we're done with that one. Maybe from the beginning we could have done this a different way. From the beginning, could we have multiplied by something? You know, early on, could we have multiplied this by something that would have given us so that this would be a nice power of, do you see how we could have done that to make life easier for ourselves? What if from the beginning we had multiplied by a fourth root of, 1 over x cubed, z cubed. Wouldn't that have made life easier for us in the beginning to make everything in the bottom have nice perfect fourths pop out? Hindsight's 20/20.
Teacher, please, I apologize.
So I've got a shout out to Tyler Clota, thank you for correcting me on that. Shout out to Sam, gets a shout out. Anybody want to give a shout out to anybody else? A shout out to D. Will, Sarah Miller. A shout out to the cross country people. A shout out to everybody giving blood. A shout out to the whole entire world. Have a great day.